हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, वेलकम बैक. माई सेल्फ पुष्पेंद्र सिंह एंड वी आर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट विद अवर डेली करंट अफेयर्स. ऑल राइट. एंड टुडे यू हैव द 19th of January 2021 एंड बेसिकली वी आर गोइंग टू कवर योर करंट अफेयर्स. दिस प्रोग्राम और दिस क्लास वुड बी यूजफुल फॉर योर यूपीएससी सिविल सर्विसेज एग्जामिनेशन एज वेल एज फॉर अदर गवर्नमेंट कॉम्पिटेटिव एग्जामिनेशन वेयर द करंट अफेयर्स पोर्शन इज सिग्निफिकेंट. So I am referring basically the two national newspapers. The first is the Hindu and the second is Indian Express. You can refer any of these newspapers, right? Both of these newspapers are equally good, or you can read both of them also, but combinedly the time should not exceed, right, say by 1.5 hours. You should not read the newspapers for 3 hours, 4 hours, because that much time is not warranted, not required also. All right. So maximum one newspaper should take 45 minutes, right? Or 1 hour, but not more than that. All right. So let's begin with our daily current affairs for 19th of January, 2021. All right. So the first news is basically related to a bike ambulance, which is also known as Rakshita, which is also known as Rakshita. So this ambulance is basically built by the DRDO, Defense Research and Development Organization. All right. So the DRDO laboratory basically designed and developed a bike ambulance. You might have heard about the ambulance. The ambulance you might have heard, you might have seen also, right? The motor ambulance, but it is a bike ambulance which is named as Rakshita. And this ambulance have been handed over to CRPF, that is Central Reserve Police Force. All right. So this this bike ambulance basically, you know, is basically manufactured by the Institute of Nuclear Medicine and Allied Sciences, Delhi, which is based in the DRDO laboratory. All right, which is basically handed over this bike ambulance to the CRPF to transport, obviously, the injured or critically injured, the personnel belong to CRPF, because you must understand. The CRPF basically, or Central Reserve Police Force, basically involved in the counter-insurgency operations. All right. The counter-insurgency operations as well as counter-terrorism operations. All right. So for both of these, sometimes what happens is if there is some, you know, the low intensity, you know, the explosion, or there is some, you know, the low profile area where not much, you know, insurgency activities are there, even in those areas where insurgency activities are more, it can transport the personnels which are basically injured during the operations. So it is basically used for the casualty evacuation, right? So here you can see basically it is fitted with the customized recycling casualty evacuation seat. So it is basically a seat which can be fitted, right, and which can be taken out from the bike as per the requirement, where the injured personnel can sit over it, right? Can be transported, can be fitted first of all over the bike, okay? The bike person can basically ride the bike and can reach to the hospital, and where the seat itself can be taken over, right? And the injured personnel can be put into the hospital, right? So something, this type of arrangement is made through this casualty evacuation seat, all right? And this bike ambulance, you know, would definitely overcome the problems which are facing by our security personnel, especially the CRPF, right, to provide certain emergency healthcare facilities to them. Because what happens is, for example, in the Chhattisgarh area or in the Jharkhand region, where you have the lush green forest, all right, very lush green forest, and it is very difficult, and also the metal roads are also not there, okay, no connectivity, in fact, in the deeper part of those, you know, villages. So what happens is it will be very difficult for the normal ambulance to reach over there sometime, and this bike ambulance would be handy for evacuation purpose of the injured patients, okay, especially from low intensity conflict areas. So it will be a boon for the security personnel, especially the CRPF, right, Cobra commandos, who are basically, you know, stationed over there for counter insurgency and counter Naxalites operations, especially in the basically red belt. All right. And this bike ambulance would basically not only useful for the not only useful for the armed personnels, but also it will be useful for the civil applications also, right? So it will have, you know, the tremendous impact on the life of the people which are basically there in the deeper part or in the isolated part of, you know, in somewhere where the operations are going on. And such ambulance can transport not only the paramilitary personnel but also the civilians also. So it will be helpful for providing this emergency medical facilities for those who are injured or critically injured. All right. So this is basically a bike ambulance. You can see here, this he is basically an injured personnel. So it is basically just in demo. So you can see the injured personnel have been just, you know, set down on the reclining, you know, the evacuation seat where the seat can be evacuated. You can see here the you know, the wheels are there. So it can be, you know, move also, it can be reclined also, and he is the basically injured person and the person who is basically riding the bike also, right? All right. Next, the first road safety month. So the road accidents are very rampant, right, in our India because of the poor infrastructure, because of poor quality of roads, right, because of the reckless driving, right, and because of insensitivity of especially for the drivers, for those, you know, pedestrians who are basically crossing the roads. So many a time what happens is the people, they basically, you know, injured those pedestrians, or sometime what happens is there are, you know, mishaps like accidents among the vehicles also because of the poor infrastructure, because of the poor quality of the roads, right? So what happens is previously the government of India used to celebrate or used to organize, you know, a weekly road safety, you know, a week, or you say the road safety week used to organize by the government of India. But this time, first time, okay, the road safety month was inaugurated. So this is the first ever national road safety month. Okay. So nowhere in the past this month or this month long program was inaugurated. Why this month-long program was inaugurated? Because you must understand, because it is a most crucial issue, right? The idea is to reduce the casualty because of these road accidents, all right? And to, you know, to increase the awareness among the people, especially, you know, the drivers, the pedestrians, right? So that we can reduce the road accidents and we can ultimately reduce those casualties over the roads, all right? Many life, you know, we lost on the roads because of this, you know, and this campaign, you know, for the same will continue till February 17th. So you see, basically, it is a 30-day or it is a 1 month long, right? The road safety month, which will be first of its kind, which was already inaugurated. And as I told you that in the previous time, right, many a time, every year, the road safety week is basically organized. But this is the first time we are organizing the road safety month, okay? Because of the importance of this issue, okay, this month-long program is inaugurated, all right. And this inaugural function, which was launched for the road safety month, right, which was launched by the Union Minister of Defense, right, and the Union Minister of Road Transport and the Highways, all right. And there are certain measures which would be taken definitely, right, to ultimately tackle or to reduce these road accidents, right, and ultimately to reduce, those casualties from the road accidents. So restructuring and re-strengthening the four E's of road safety. So that is how we are basically, you know, making. So you see basically restructuring. That means whatever the engineering applications you are having, you are basically restructure them, right? And strengthen them. So the first is basically engineering applications, right? So for example, in the transportation engineering, right? It is the one branch of civil engineering where, you know, the road transport or the roads have been constructed, right? Or there is a domain for the road construction, bridge construction, and something like that. Okay, so there are a lot of, you know, the measures which have to be taken in the transportation side, especially on the road alignment, right? The side distance, overtaking side distance, right? And many such engineering, you know, applications has to be incorporated. So many a time what happens is our roads are not as per the code requirement, because there is always a code for constructing the road, right? So sometimes what happens is the overtaking distance is not adequate, right? The, you know, it will be very difficult for the vehicles to pass through also, right? So all such engineering techniques would be involved, and it will be incorporated in this month. And education, obviously education is most prominent, right? Not only for the pedestrians, but also for the people who are driving them, who are driving the vehicles, right? So to make them aware about the you know, rules and regulations regarding the road safety, right? Obviously, you know, the educated, you know, or most aware the persons, right? It will be more, you know, helpful for those, you know, safety related aspects. Enforcement. Enforcement means whoever breaks the law, right? Whoever breaks the law or whoever basically, you know, break these protocols related to the, you know, the road transport, right? He will be punished for that. So enforcement measurement is also most important, right? So enforcement is one of the most important or most crucial aspect of the road safety. Because many times what happens is we do not fear, right? About law enforcement agencies, and we just take them very lightly because we know that they won't do anything. So the enforcement measurement is also most important. And emergency care services, this is what is most crucial also, because after all, you made everything, engineering techniques, education, educated the people, you have the good enforcement, but still there is always possibility of the road fatalities or road accidents, right? So you need to have, you know, the vibrant evacuation system where you can basically, you know, evacuate those persons who are critically injured out of this, you know, accidents. So the emergency care services should be vital, should be vibrant, and should be, you know, adequately available nearby to those spots. And you need to identify also those black spots which are more prone to those accidents. All right. So it is basically, the quotation is, the practicing road safety is more important than preaching it. Sometimes we preach, but we don't practice in reality, right? So it is basically, we should practice more than what we preach, obviously, right? All right. The next is basically Orvokal Airport. Okay. So it is basically a greenfield airport. First of all, the greenfield, there are two types of infrastructure, right? One is a greenfield and another is basically brownfield, right? The greenfield is one which is basically the newly constructed or newly developed on the new piece of the land, right? So it is called greenfield. So Orvokal Airport, first of all, is a greenfield airport, which is basically constructed, right, as one of the 50 low-cost airport, right, to enhance the connectivity, right? So it is basically why this Orvokal Airport is in the news, because the Director General of Civil Aviation, right, has accorded the aerodrome license, right, for the Orvokal Airport for the public use. All right. So the aerodrome license have been accorded. Now this airport can be used for transportation purpose, right? For transporting the persons, right? And it is basically, you know, constructed at the outskirts of Kurnool city in Andhra Pradesh. All right. So as I told you that Orvokal Airport is one of the 50 low-cost airport which is basically proposed across the country, right, under the Ude Desh Ka Aam Nagrik, right? So, you know, you must understand there is, you know, obviously the point of constructing this low-cost airport to enhance the connectivity, especially those far-flung areas, especially those remote areas, right? And so that the people can use it, and we can also use those, you know, those facilities also for, you know, for energy efficiency also. All right. And the foundation stone for this Orvokal Airport was laid in June 2017, and the airport is inaugurated in January 2019. All right. So it has been already accorded the aerodrome license. All right. So this is basically the Orvokal Airport. All right. So next, FAO Food Price Index. So you see here, the Food and Agriculture Organization, right? It is basically an international organization which basically, you know, basically publishes the food price index. Okay. So here what happens is the news is related to the food prices basically rose for the seventh consecutive month, right, in the December. So the world food prices, it is not India related, but it is the world food prices which rose, right, in the seventh consecutive months. All right. And, you know, except the sugar, almost all categories, almost all commodities, the food prices basically rose. All right. It is basically the FAO, which is nothing but the United Nations Food Agency, which is responsible for controlling and regulating the food prices, all right, and which also publishes the food price index. The food price index is nothing but a measure of the monthly change in the international prices of the basket of food commodities. So here you can see the monthly change, whatever the changes happens in the basket of food commodities, right? Especially in the international prices, the FAO or the Food and Agriculture Organizations, the food price index basically, measured that change or measured that monthly change in the international prices, especially for the food commodities, all right. And it generally consists of the food price index generally consists of the five commodity group, right? Which include basically, you can see basically, the cereals, vegetables, dairy, meat, and sugar, all right. And it is basically weighted with the average export share. So it is basically involvement or it basically, consists of average of the five commodities. The five commodities are cereals, vegetable, dairy, meat, and sugar, all right. And for this year, right, you can see basically, as I told you that it has increased. It has increased. So in the December, it was 107.5 points. So the food price index average, when you compare, because it is an average of five commodity group, right? When we quantify the food price index, so the index basically averaged at 107.5 points in the December 2020, right? And it was 105.2 in November 2020. So you see, basically, it has increased from 105 to 107. Okay. When you calculate or when you quantify the food price index for whole of 2020, okay, it was 97.9 points. But this itself is, it's 3-year high according to the data which is published by the Food and Agriculture Organization, and it is basically the 3.1% increase from 2019. So when you compare, with 2019, this data itself 3.1% higher, or this index is 3.1% higher, all right. And when you compare the 2020 itself, it is 3-year high. That means if you compare the last 3 years, it is a 3-year high consecutively, and it is 3.1% increase when you compare just previous year, that is 2019. All right. Next, the new Anubhavana Mantapa, right? So what is this new Anubhavana Mantapa? So you must understand that there is, one, philosopher or one philosopher who was known as the Vasa Visveshwara, right? The Vasa Visveshwara basically was a poet. He was basically a 12th century poet, right? And the most important aspect of, the Vasa Visveshwara is related to the Lingayat community, right? Because it is basically relevant to those Lingayat community. So what happens is the Lingayat is a separate sect, right? Within the Hindu. So here you see basically the Karnataka chief minister basically, promised long back to construct this new Anubhavana Mantapa, okay? At basically, the birthplace of or the place where, the philosopher Vasa Visveshwara basically lived most of his life. So he lived most of his life basically in Basav Kalyan, right? It is the place in the Karnataka. So the foundation stone for the new, Anubhavana Mantapa, which will be, having certain, the aspect of pilgrimage. So it will be a construction of a project, right? So this project will have, the most important teachings of Vasa Visveshwara, okay? This Vasa Visveshwara basically is, most important icon of the Veerashaiva Lingayat community, who is basically found in the Karnataka, only in the Karnataka. And this, the new Anubhavana Mantapa, which is, a project for construction of, the pilgrimage site, right? It is the most important, it will be the most important pilgrimage site for the Veerashaiva Lingayat community. It was proposed way back in 2016 also. Now the foundation stone for the same is laid by the Karnataka chief minister, all right. And you know, this Vasava Kalyan is basically the most important pilgrimage center for the Lingayat, because it has the religious significance. What is the significance? That the philosopher who was also known as the Vasa Vasheshwara basically lived most of his life, and he is basically associated with the Veera Shaiva Lingayat community. So mainly the Lingayat community's people basically, you know, basically move to the Vasava Kalyan, which is also the most important pilgrimage center for the Lingayats. All right. And this new Anubhava Mantapa, right, which is basically, you know, as I told you, it is basically, you know, just like a pilgrimage site or a structure, which will have, you know, the sixth floor, or which will have the six floors, and it will also cover 7.5 acres plot, right? So in between 7.5 acres plot, the structure will be built, which will have the six floors, and this structure will have, you know, the demonstration or the depiction of especially the principles of the Vasa Vasheshwara, who is basically also the most important icon of the Veera Shaiva Lingayat community, right? So the principles of Vasa Vasheshwara philosophy will be depicted over there, and it will also showcase the why we say basically the Anubhava Mantapa. It is basically referred to the first parliament of the world, right? And which was established by himself, who was also the Vasa Vasheshwara, right? And basically he was established in Vasa Kalyan, which is basically a place in the Karnataka, all right? And he was the philosopher, and he was also the social reformer. All such debates related to the philosophy, all such debates related to the social reform, right? His teachings used to be conducted over the place which is known as Vasa Kalyan. So for his memory, right? For his religious significance, right? And for his, the pilgrimage importance, this structure or new Anubhava Mantapa or the first parliament of the world would be constructed, right? In the Vasa Kalyan, right? And this building would adopt the Kalyana Chalukya style of architecture. So it is a one class of architecture, right? Based on the Chalukya, all right, of Badami, right? All right. So it will be the, you know, the Mantapa, which will be constructed in this format. All right. Next is Raj Iyer. So he is basically, you must understand, he is an Indian American, and he is basically the most important, right? He is the most important, you know, or one of the highest ranking, the civilian in the US Department of Defense. Now, why he is in the news, or why the Indian American Raj Iyer is in the news? Because he's going to, take over as a first chief information officer of US Army, right? The chief information officer is, you know, this post is recently created by the Pentagon, right? In 2020, and he will be holding, or Raj Iyer, who is basically the Indian American, who will be holding the first chief information officer of the US Army, which was recently created. All right. And as I told you that he is the most important or high ranking Indian American civilian in the US Department of Defense. And regarding his, you know, the previous post he was holding, so Dr. Iyer basically is or was the principal advisor to the Secretary of the Army, as it is written here. And he also directs the representation of the Secretary in the matters related to the information management and matters related to the information technology. So you see here, he has very high stake or very high ranking, especially in the US Department of the Defense. And that is the reason he was appointed as a first chief information officer, right, of the US Army. All right. And regarding his rank of the chief information officer, so you basically see this chief information officer, the rank is almost equal to the three-star general in the US Army. Right, and he will basically have the power to supervise the annual budget of around 16 million, right, of the US Army, especially the IT operation or information technology operations. All right, and under him, around 15,000 civilians and the military personnel would be posted across the 100 countries, and he would be basically supervising that. All right, and he is basically Dr. Raj Iyer. All right, next. Harike Wetland. So it is the basically a wetland which is basically located in the Punjab. All right. So what happens is why it is the news? Because it is most important, the word site, or it is the, you know, the migratory words used to come and they used to come for some time in this backland. So it is the, you know, the place for those migratory words. So this Harike wetland is basically, you know, falls in the path of the Central Asian Flyway. The Central Asian Flyway basically, you know, is a flyway where the migratory birds used to migrate from the Central Asian countries, like, you know, many Central Asian countries from Siberia to the Indian, you know, to the Indian landmass, right? So they migrate from those areas because of the chilling winter, right? There, the winter is very severe, right? To safeguard themselves, the birds basically migrate every year. And they used to come to the Harike wetland. Many such wetlands are there in our India. One is the Harike wetland. Another is, you can also see the, you know, the Kevla Dev National Park in the Bharatpur, Rajasthan, right? The another wetland is Kevla Dev. Kevla Dev wetland or national park. Okay, it is also the bird sanctuary. It is also the bird sanctuary. Okay, where the migratory birds used to come. Okay, this Kevla Dev National Park is located in Bharatpur, Rajasthan. All right, so one such wetland is this also. There are many such wetlands, right? So where the winter migratory birds used to come, right? They used to, you know, give birth to their small kids, right? You know, and then they teach them, you know, to fly, and then after winter they used to go back. They used to go back to their the parent land, right? So for the world watchers or for the world lovers, it will be, you know, very delight to see them once again. So it is also, this Harike wetland is also known as Harike Pattan, right? In basically in the Punjabi language, right? And with Harike Lake in the deeper part of it, it is the largest wetland. It is the largest wetland in the northern India, right? And it is basically located in the border of the Tarn Taran Sahib district and the Ferozpur district of the Punjab. All right. So it is mainly located, basically, you see, basically in the border of Tarn Taran Sahib district and the Ferozpur district of Punjab. All right. And the wetland and, you know, this lake, which is also known as, you know, the Harike Lake, right, were formed by constructing the headworks across the Satluj River in 1953. All right. So the headworks means the basically, you know, the river was, was stopped, or it was basically embankment, right, to construct this wetland or to make this lake, right? And it was basically later converted into, you know, the most important world area also. All right. And this headwork is located, right, especially in the downstream of the confluence of the Bees and the Satluj rivers, just south of a Harike village. So it is just a geographical feature of the Harike wetland. Okay. And it has been designed as a most important Ramsar site. Ramsar is basically a Ramsar convention. Okay. It is based on the Ramsar convention. The Ramsar sites have been demarcated. Okay. These Ramsar sites are having, you know, the international importance, and which is basically also require the significant amount of, you know, the conservation effort, right? All right. So it is based on the Ramsar convention. All right. So it is basically the Harike wetland. Okay. Next, the bank investment company. Okay. So it is the news from the Economics. So you see, basically, you know, what happens is there is always a shortage, or there is always, you know, the problem related to the liquidity with the bank. So what happens is, you know, the zero coupon bonds basically is a concept where the banks basically issue the zero coupon bonds, right? Especially to the public. The main purpose is, you know, to recapitalize the public sector banks, right? So, you know, what happens is, you know, by just offering or by just issuing of zero coupon bonds or zero interest coupon bonds, what happens is, you know, for recapitalizing of the, you know, public sector banks, there are a lot of issues related to this recapitalization, related to issuing of this zero coupon bonds. So RBI has basically certain concern over the issuance of such bonds. Okay. And so what happens is, in this context, the finance ministry or Union Finance Ministry is basically, you know, looking into another avenues other than the zero coupon bond, which can be utilized, right? And which can be also affordable, right? Where you can affordably, you know, infuse the capital, right? Capital infusion is a process where you basically, you know, pump the amount of money, especially to those banks which require the finance or which require the liquidity, right? It is process called capital infusion. Okay, so the finance ministry is basically, you know, is basically finding or examining especially those avenues where the capital infusion can be made, right? And in this context the finance ministry also examining, you know, the setting up of the bank investment company. Okay, so this is basically a context for the setting up of this bank investment company. Now let's understand what is this bank investment company. Okay, so bank investment company is a holding company, right? Or is a core investment company. The main purpose of this bank investment company is to raise the money, right? To recapitalize the bank, right? And this bank investment company, right? Ultimately name itself says bank investment company, right? So it will invest definitely. So here what happens is the bank investment company was suggested by the PJ Naik committee, right? In his report, which was titled as the governance of the boards of banks of India, right? Under this report, the PJ Naik committee basically recommended the setting up of the bank investment company. Okay, and this report itself, right, recommended that, you know what happens is in every bank, the government has certain stake in every bank. For example, in many banks, government has more than 51% stake. That is what we call them the public sector banks, right? Because the majority shares are held by the government of India, which is also public. So it is publicly held. So that is why we call them public sector undertakings, right? Or public sector banks, because the majority shares are held by the government, which is nothing but a public, right? So here what happens is this PJ Naik committee basically recommended that the shares or the transferring of the shares, especially those shares which are held by the government to the bank investment company. So those shares which are held by the government will be transferred to the bank investment company, right? And which would become, you know, parent holding company of these all banks. So this bank investment company will become a parent holding company, right? And, you know, as a result, this would become a parent holding company and the banks or public sector banks will become a limited bank and it will be helpful for recapitalization of those banks in the longer run. All right. So it is the news related to the bank investment company. All right. Next, the river pollution. Okay. So all you know about the river pollution. So river pollution is very rampant in India. All right. Our rivers are polluted, very highly polluted. And Indian rivers are, you know, among the world highly polluted rivers. So because of lot of issues, because of untreated effluent, which is released in the water bodies, especially in the rivers, right? Irregularities, right? The incapacity, right, of those, you know, the regulatory agencies, right, law enforcement agencies, and the attitude of the people, right, insensitivity towards, you know, the pollution, right? Many such issues, mainly the anthropogenic issues, right? The overpopulation, right? The untreatment of those, you know, the effluent or, you know, the, you know, polluted water, right? If you treat the polluted water and then release to the water bodies, it will be okay. But what is happening is this polluted water released directly to the water bodies, and which is also a cause of the river pollution. So here what happens is this untreated industrial effluent is basically released into the rivers in the Gujarat, right? And which is also causing the pollution in the Sabarmati, which is also a river, Mahisagar, Narmada, and Vishwamitri and Badar. These are all the rivers, right, which are, you know, cause of concern because of increasing in the pollution or increasing the pollution level, especially in those the rivers which flows in the Gujarat, right? So here the data which is basically, you know, taken from the Ministry of Environment and the Forest, okay, the Sabarmati River basically flows through, say, Ahmedabad also. it is the most important or it is the most polluted rivers in our country, right? Is among the most polluted rivers, and it is basically, you know, because of the mostly anthropogenic regions or because of the human made regions. And the Gujarat ranks fourth among the top five states which has the highly polluted rivers, right? So Gujarat is among the top most four states, or you know, or top most, you know, the five states exact rank is fourth among the highly polluted rivers, all right, and which as many as 20 rivers is critically polluted category. So Government of India has made this, you know, the rankings based on this categorization of those rivers. So 20 such rivers are critically polluted, and the most important parameter of finding, you know, the river pollution is chemical oxygen demand, all right. So the chemical oxygen demand, which is a parameter, right, which indicate the oxygen pollutant, organic pollutant load, right? So here the COD or chemical oxygen demand is higher than 250 mg per or milligram per liter, all right. And which, you know, if those COD is more than 250 milligrams per liter, it should be first treated. It should be treated and then released, then released. But what is happening is that the COD or chemical oxygen demand, right, is even if more than 250, you know, milligrams per liter, right, it is released to the water body. So it is also causing the pollution. And based on the data which is published by the ministry, you see basically the Gujarat rivers has the basically the COD levels in the tune of 700 to 1000 milligram per liter, which is much higher than what is prescribed or what is mandated to have, right? So the COD is much more, which is in the range of the 700 to 1000 milligram per liter, which is much higher side, right? And the dissolved oxygen, all right, so dissolved oxygen is needed for you know, for flora and fauna to sustain in the water, especially, right? So you know, these dissolved oxygen would provide, you know, the oxygen to you know, the species which are residing in the water, right? And what happens is if the dissolved oxygen is much lower, right, so it is basically causing the anaerobic conditions where, you know, only anaerobic bacteria can stay. Otherwise the aerobic conditions, you know, can flourish, aerobic bacteria and other, you know, the species also. But what happens is because of this overpollution, right, this dissolved oxygen level, DO level, is basically falling. When this DO level is falling, what happens is the anaerobic condition is occurring, and this is basically, basically causing, you know, so much, you know, the depletion of those, the flora and the faunal composition, especially in the water bodies. You see here, the DO level in the perennial rivers like Mahisagar should be in the range of 6 to 8 milligrams per liter, and which is actually below than 2.9 milligrams per liter. So you see basically the DO level should be 6 to 8, but what is exactly is 2.9 milligrams per liter. So if the DO level is less, what will happen? Obviously, right, many fish species will die, right? Because the fish also require the dissolved oxygen to sustain. If those dissolved oxygen is not there, obviously what will happen? It will be critically polluted, and no such, you know, the you know, the organism will survive in this low level of dissolved oxygen in the water bodies. And low level of dissolved oxygen in the water bodies also suggests that it is highly polluted. It is highly polluted. All right. Next, Furfura pilgrimage, right? Furfura pilgrimage. So Furfura pilgrimage is basically associated with, first of all, you must understand, is a Muslim pilgrimage site, right? And it is basically, you know, is also becoming the epicenter of Muslim politics in the West Bengal. So the Furfura site is basically a Muslim pilgrimage site. Okay. Now, it is also known as Furfura Sharif, just like on the tunes of Ajmer Sharif, which is located in the Ajmer district of Rajasthan. So Furfura Sharif, right, which is sometimes also known as Furfura Darbar Sahib. It is basically a village which is located in the Hooghly district of West Bengal, right, which is basically a holy place for the Bengali Muslims, especially for the Bengali Muslims for the pilgrimage purpose, right? And and the people, especially the Muslims or Bengali Muslims, they basically queue up, right, in the mazar. Mazar means a shrine at the Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiqui, right, which was also most prominent peer or the holy person of the town of, you know, this Hooghly district of, you know, of the West Bengal. And people say, or the people of the West Bengal, especially the Muslims, used to say that it is the second most important mazar, right, in the country after Ajmer Sharif in the Rajasthan. So it is the most important mazar or most important, you know, the shrine after the Ajmer Sharif, which is located in the Rajasthan. All right. So it is basically the most important mazar. All right. So you can see the picture of, you know, the Furfuri, you know, the pilgrimage site. All right. So thank you very much for this session. We will meet again tomorrow for our new current affairs. So thank you very much for those who attend this session. Thank you.